Good morning, beloved. This morning we want to continue the series that we started last week, our study in the book of Colossians. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to our scripture reading in Colossians chapter 1. This morning we're going to look at verses 3 to 14. Where we're going to read about and study about Paul's expression of gratitude to God the Father for the faith of the Colossians and also his prayer for their spiritual growth. Last week we did an introduction to the book of Colossians, and I want to begin by just reviewing very quickly some of the things that we looked at last week. Because again, whenever we study the Word of God, you always want to understand the historical background and the context of why the author wrote the epistle or the letter, and that way you can understand it a lot better. If you were not here last week and you did not get one of these introductions to Colossians, you may pick one up on your way out after the service at the usher's desk. We do have some extra copies available. So let's have a word of prayer and ask the Lord once again to speak to us through his word. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your great love for us. And thank you for the word of God, which is truly a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And Father, we thank you for the book of Colossians. And we pray once again this morning that as we study this book together, that you might enable us by your Spirit to understand what your word is teaching, its meaning, how it applies to our life, and then may we live our lives in light of its glorious truths. So we thank you for this time, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, last week we saw in our introduction that the book of Colossians was written by the Apostle Paul. We saw that at the end of Acts chapter 28, Paul was under house arrest in prison in Rome, and it was during those 2 years that he wrote this book of Colossians, but he also wrote Ephesians, Philippians, and also Philemon. We saw that the city of Colossae was located about 170 kilometers east of Ephesus in modern-day Turkey. It was the Roman province of Asia at the time. And we saw that there was really no story in the book of Acts about the founding of this church. But we do know that Paul was in Ephesus for 3 years preaching the gospel, and many of the people all throughout that Roman province of Asia came to Ephesus, heard Paul preach the gospel, put their faith in Christ, and then went back to their hometowns. We know that Philemon, who was from Colossae, he was a Colossian. He was led to Christ by the Apostle Paul. And the one who planted the church there in Colossae was a man by the name of Epaphras. And we're going to look a little bit about Epaphras today, who had preached the gospel in Colossae and established the church. Now, at this time, the reason why Paul wrote this letter was because false teachers had come to Colossae, just like false teachers always attack the Church of Jesus Christ with false teaching. And so these false teachers came in. They were teaching Jewish legalism, man-made philosophy, and Oriental mysticism. And Paul was going to exhort them that they need to follow Christ, to grow in Christ and walk in Christ, and not through these other things. Because of these false teachers, Epaphras left Colossae and he went to Rome. And to see the Apostle Paul, he told Paul all that was going in Colossae, and then Paul wrote this letter for the Colossians in order to deal with these issues. So we saw that there was at least three purposes of why Paul wrote this letter. Number one was to instruct them about the preeminence of Jesus Christ in all things. That we're not to follow man-made philosophy or legalism. Jesus Christ is to have the preeminence in every aspect of our life. Secondly, to warn them about the moral and doctrinal errors of these false teachers, and then to exhort them to live holy, righteous lives to the glory of God. And we saw some of the distinctives about the book of Colossians. One, that again, the emphasis on the preeminence of Jesus Christ. Next week, we're going to look at that glorious passage in Colossians chapter 1 about the person and the reconciliation ministry of the Lord Jesus. And so we also saw that the letter carrier of this epistle was who? Do you remember who carried this letter? Who was it? Tychicus, right? How can you forget Tychicus? And that Onesimus, the runaway slave who Paul led to Christ, accompanied Tychicus as he brought this letter. All right? We also saw last week, we looked at the first two verses of Colossians chapter 1, which was the greeting. And Paul wrote that he was the author, he was an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy was with him in Rome when he wrote this letter, and he was writing to the saints and the faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, and God's grace and God's peace was what Paul desired to be abundant in the life of the Colossians. So today we're going to pick it up in verse 3. If you have your Bibles open, look at Colossians chapter 1. We're going to begin at verse 3. And this passage today is divided up into two sections. In verses 3 through 8, Paul is going to express his gratitude to God the Father for the faith of the Colossians. And so we'll look at the gratitude for the Colossians' faith. But then in the second part of our passage today, in verses 9 to 14, Paul is going to tell us and the Colossians his fourfold prayer request for them. Because ever since Paul had heard about the faith of the Colossians, he prayed for them every single time that he thought about them. And as we read about what Paul's prayer requests, that helps us to understand how we should pray for one another. And we're going to see the things that were most dominant in Paul's thinking about what they needed prayer about. So let's look first of all at verses 3 through 8, his gratitude for the Colossians' faith. We begin in verse 3 where Paul writes this. Paul writes, "We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you." So here Paul writes to the Colossians and he says, listen, every time we pray to God the Father, we pray and we pray for you, we thank God for you. And that's something that we as believers should always be thankful for, and that is the grace of God and the salvation that God has given to other believers. Whenever we think about brothers and sisters in the Lord, whether here at GCF East, whether in other countries, wherever, we should always thank God for them. In Romans chapter 1, verse 8, Paul wrote the same thing, that he always thanked God for the Romans, for their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you. Why, Paul? Why did you thank God for the Romans? Because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. And we're going to see that thanksgiving, having a heart of thanksgiving to God, is something that as believers we should maintain consistently in our life. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians and said, pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. It is the will of God for us to be a grateful, thankful people who are always thanking the Lord, especially for the salvation of others. By the way, beloved, what's the opposite of being grateful and giving thanks? What is it? You know what the opposite is? Complaining. And Paul had written to the Philippians, do all things without murmuring and complaining. All right, because we have that tendency to grumble, to complain. But Paul says, no, we need to have an attitude of thanksgiving. And we're going to see later on that that's one of his four prayer requests for the Colossians, that they too would continually be giving thanks to God. And so Paul always thanked God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when he prayed for them. And then he mentions in verse 4 and verse 5a that Paul prayed for them ever since he heard about three things that was in their lives. And those three things are faith, love, and hope. Notice when he began praying for them, verse 4, it says this: since we heard of your what? Faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope that is laid up for you in heaven. And so here Paul writes that he would thank God the Father for them ever since he heard about their faith in the Lord Jesus. Remember last week we mentioned that Paul had never met the Colossians. He had never seen them face to face. He had never been to Colossae. And so when he heard about their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, he gave thanks to God the Father for them. Now this faith that he's referring to is saving faith. This is the faith that is spoken of by the Lord Jesus in that very well-known verse, John 3:16. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And Jesus said, whoever believes on the Lord Jesus Christ will not perish, but have everlasting life. And when Epaphras preached the gospel in Colossae, the Colossians heard that the Lord Jesus Christ had died for their sins, that God raised him from the dead. And they put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and were born again of the Spirit of God. And so that's the faith that the Colossians had that caused Paul to thank God for them. Their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But you know, beloved, true saving faith will always bring about changes in the life of the believer. 2 Corinthians 5:17, right? If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. One change that will take place in the life of a person who has true saving faith is they will begin to love other believers. That is an evidence, a mark of a true believer. And so Paul, again, writes in verse 4 that he gave thanks to God the Father since he heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the what? Love that you have for all the saints. Epaphras told Paul, "Paul, listen, the Colossians really have a love and a burden for other believers." And that love for other believers, again, is evidence of their true saving faith. And Paul just thanked God, not just for their faith in Christ Jesus, but their love for all the saints. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9, Paul wrote to the Thessalonian believers and said, "Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another." You see, when God gives you his Holy Spirit, God teaches you through his Spirit to have a love and a desire to be with other believers. I remember when I came to a saving knowledge of the Lord, first thing I wanted to do, first time in my life, was go to church. Not because I wanted to be bored or but I wanted to be with other believers. I wanted to talk to other believers. I wanted to fellowship with other believers. I had a love that the Lord gave me for other believers. And every single true believer in the Lord Jesus Christ is going to have a love for other believers. And may I say to you, if you don't have a love for other believers, you better examine yourself to find out whether you're really in the faith. Now, that doesn't mean other believers might not frustrate you at times. All right, we know that we fail each other every from time to time. No, there's those frustrations, but there's still that love and for other believers. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 1, John wrote, "Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him." So if we truly have been born of God and we love the Father, then we also will have a love for other believers, those who were born of Him. You ever hear the saying, birds of a feather, what? Flock together, right? Birds of a feather flock together. And true believers, again, have a love for other believers. And the Colossians had that. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, Paul also prayed for the Ephesians. And we see their faith in the Lord Jesus and their love of other believers. He writes, "For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your," what? "Love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers." So again, we see that true saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ results in a love for other believers. And if there's one thing that we here at GCF East need to do and maintain, is a consistent faith in the Lord Jesus. We learn that from the book of Hebrews. And we need to consistently love one another and show, demonstrate love toward each other. And so Paul thanked God for them ever since he heard of their faith in Christ Jesus and their love for all the saints. Now, thirdly, he says this, because, verse 5a, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Because of means on account of. You see, the Colossians not only had faith and love, they had a hope laid up for them in heaven. They believed in the blessed hope of every single believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. We've studied this before. We find it in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, where Paul writes that we are waiting for our blessed hope. And what is that hope? The appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. That blessed hope that every single believer is looking forward to, the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, when He sets up His eternal kingdom, and when we receive our eternal inheritance. And the Colossians were looking forward to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Their hope, just like yours and mine, is laid up in heaven. That's where Jesus is. And His return and all that goes with it is our hope. That's what we're living for. That's what we're looking forward to. And they had this blessed hope laid up for them in heaven. Peter wrote about this in 1 Peter 1, verses 3 to 5. Peter wrote, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Praise God the Father. Why, Peter? "According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." You see, we have a living hope. Jesus is alive and He's in heaven. And so not only are we waiting for the blessed hope of His return, the God the Father has also called us to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept where? In heaven, for you who by God's power are being guarded through faith for that salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. And so, beloved, Paul, thank God for the Colossians' saving faith. He thanked God for their love for the other Christians. And he thanked God for the blessed hope that they were looking forward to and that they were living their lives in light of. And so you and I, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, should be thanking God for the faith, the love, and the hope that other believers have. And we need to walk in these things ourselves. And so Paul prayed for them and gave thanksgiving ever since he heard of this. And how did they hear? What was the message that they heard that told them about their blessed hope laid up for them in heaven? Well, in verse 5b and verse 6, we find out that they heard it through the word of God, through the gospel. It says, of this, that blessed hope, you have heard before in the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed in all the whole world, it is bearing fruit and increasing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. Here we see two things that Paul writes about the gospel. They learned about the hope that was laid up for them in heaven through the word of truth, through the gospel. And beloved, same thing with us. How do we know about what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us? How do we know about the blessed hope that we have? It's through the study and the understanding of the teaching of the word of God, through the gospel, the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ is the way we know about these things, just the way the Colossians did. So they learned of this through the word of truth. And then Paul writes this. This is something that we really need to understand as believers. And that is that the gospel bears fruit. Beloved, listen very carefully. The preaching of the gospel works. It's very important that you understand that, because there are some in evangelical Christianity today who have the idea that the gospel in and of itself is ineffective. It doesn't really work. And that is totally unbiblical thinking. The Bible teaches the exact opposite. That the Bible, or that the gospel message, is powerful and it is effective and it results in salvation. Verse 6, talking about the gospel, Paul writes, which has come to you, Colossians, the gospel came to you, as indeed in the whole world it is what? It's bearing fruit and it's increasing, as it also does among you since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. And so here Paul affirms that the preaching of the gospel is effective, and that the Colossians, when they heard the gospel, it was effective in their life and it brought forth the fruit of salvation when they believed the message. And beloved, today the gospel is still bearing fruit. The gospel still works as we faithfully witness to unbelievers and share the gospel with them. The Spirit of God will convict them of the truth of the message and give them the faith to believe. That's why Paul wrote in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul wrote, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Why, Paul? For it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. You see, beloved, the power is in the message. He says the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. And you know from your own personal experience that the gospel came to you not just in word only, but in power and in the Spirit. And you put your faith in Christ. The gospel works. The gospel is effective. In Acts chapter 2, verse 41, we saw how the gospel was effective right from the start. Right after the day of Pentecost, the beginning of the church, and Peter was preaching the gospel on the day of Pentecost, it tells us, so those who received his word, they believed the gospel, were baptized, and they were added that day about what? 3,000 souls. Down in verse 47, it says, they were praising God, having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to their number, day by day, those who were being saved. So as the apostles were preaching the gospel, day by day, it was effective, and people were getting saved. Later on in Acts chapter 13, when Paul was on the first missionary journey in Pisidian Antioch, in Pisidia, in Galatia, it tells us in chapter 13, verses 48 and 49, that when Paul preached the gospel in the synagogue, it says, "And when the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many as were appointed to eternal life," what? "Believed. And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region." So that whole region of Galatia and Pisidian Antioch, as Paul was preaching the gospel, it was effective. And many put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Later on in Acts chapter 19, verse 20, it tells us, "So the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily." In other words, it was increasing and many were coming to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, beloved, we have to understand that for 2,000 years, the gospel message has been effective. And people have been coming to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ through the proclamation of the gospel, through the explanation of the gospel as we witness, and it will continue to bear fruit all the way to the end. So don't believe those who would tell you that the preaching of the gospel is not enough, that you also have to have whatever to go with it, because the gospel bears fruit unto salvation. So who did the Colossians hear the gospel from? Well, going back to verses 7 and 8, we see, this is the end of his gratitude for their faith, that it was through a man by the name of Epaphras. And we're going to see four things about Epaphras here in verses 7 and 8. Paul writes this, "Just as you learned it," they heard the gospel, they heard the word of God, "just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant." Don't you love that? Paul refers to Epaphras, no spirit of competition here. He refers to him as our beloved fellow servant. "He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and has made known to us your love in the Spirit." And so here we find out that Epaphras was the one who evangelized the city of Colossae, preached the gospel there. All right, now he was in Rome with Paul, and he points out that, again, the Colossians had learned the gospel, the word of God, from Epaphras. And four things about him. Number one, we see that they heard the gospel through him. Not only was Epaphras their pastor, he was an evangelist. He was preaching the gospel and led many of them to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. They heard the gospel through him. A second thing we see about Epaphras is that he was a beloved fellow servant of Paul. And again, we see Paul's attitude toward Epaphras was that he loved him and saw him as a fellow servant. You remember when we studied 1 Corinthians together? How the Corinthians had a problem by choosing their favorite Bible teacher, and they were dividing because they didn't look at their Paul and Apollos as fellow, beloved fellow servants. And Paul would have none of that. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 through 9, we studied this together last year. Paul wrote, "What then is Apollos? Who's Apollos? And who is Paul? What is Paul? We're merely servants. We're fellow servants through whom you believed as the Lord assigned to each. I planted," Paul preached the gospel there originally, "Apollos watered," Apollos came to town and built on that foundation and taught them the word of God, "but God is the one who gave the growth. So neither he who plants," that's Paul, "nor he who waters is anything," all right? "But God is everything. He who plants and he who waters are one. There's unity amongst ministers, and each will receive his wages according to his labor We are God's fellow workers, and you are God's field, God's building. So here again, we see that Paul had absolutely no sense of competition with other ministers. He said, no, we are just beloved fellow laborers. But here he also points out that we are also God's fellow workers in the preaching of the gospel. And so we see the love that Paul had toward Epaphras and the appreciation that Paul had for the ministry of Epaphras. And beloved, we need to have a love and an appreciation for the ministry of all the ministers of the gospel who preach the gospel in truth and in sincerity. And so Epaphras was the one they heard the gospel through. He was a beloved fellow servant of Paul. And thirdly, Paul writes that he is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf. Again, he was a faithful minister to the Colossians when he was in Colossae, and now he was their representative coming to Paul in Rome, and he was ministering to Paul on behalf of the Colossians. But do you know that even while Epaphras was in Rome, he still was ministering to the Colossians? Do you know how? Well, in chapter 4, verses 12 and 13, Paul wrote this. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. So even when he was in Rome, Paul was ministering fervently in prayer to God the Father on behalf of the Colossians that they might continue to grow and glorify God in their lives. And so he truly was a faithful minister to the Colossians. And lastly, it says in verse 8 that Epaphras was the one who has made known to us your love in the Spirit. Epaphras told Paul, Timothy, the others that were there in Rome about their love in the Holy Spirit, in the Spirit that the Colossians had. And so here, just in these verses 3 to 8, as Paul expresses his gratitude for the Colossians' faith, we see that he thanked God ever since he heard about their faith, their love, their hope. They learned it in the gospel, which Epaphras was the one who preached to them. So this was Paul's brief section in verses 3 to 8 about his gratitude for their faith. But then in verses 9 to 14, in the second half of this section, Paul is going to write to the Colossians and tell them what his prayer requests were when he prayed to the Father for them. And beloved, here we learn how, as believers, we should be praying for one another. All right? Let's look at his prayer for the Colossians' spiritual growth and the fourfold prayer request that he had. Look at verse 9. Verse 9, Paul writes this, and so, from the day we heard, that's from the day he heard about their faith in the Lord Jesus, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you. Paul prayed without ceasing on behalf of the Colossians. And what did he pray for them? Asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Paul's number one prayer request for the Colossians was that they would grow in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of God's word and God's will. Paul's number one prayer request was that the Colossians would know the word of God through and through, that they would grow in their knowledge, their understanding, in wisdom, in the Word of God. And beloved, as we pray for one another, we need to include in our prayer requests that we would grow in our knowledge, our understanding, in the Word of God and the will of God. It wasn't just Paul. Peter also, the very last thing he wrote before he was martyred, in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, this is what Peter writes to a group of believers that he often ministered to. In 2 Peter 3:18, Peter wrote, "But grow in the grace and what? Knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen." And so Peter here is exhorting these believers with his dying words to continue to grow in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of the Word of God and the will of God. So prayer request number one was for knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Number two, we look at verse 10. And here Paul points out that, you know, we don't study the Word of God just for intellectual knowledge, okay? So we can impress people about how much Bible we know. No, we learn the Word of God so that we can obey the Word of God and we can live lives in our conduct, in our behavior that glorify God. And so in verse 10, prayer request number two is so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. So Paul's second prayer request was that as they grew in knowledge, they would walk worthy of the Lord, that they would bear fruit in their lives. And again, here he's referring to our conduct, our behavior, that we live holy, righteous lives that are pleasing to the Lord, and that we are filled with spiritual fruit. You know, the Bible teaches different kinds of fruit. In Galatians 5, 22 and 23, we see the fruit of the Spirit. Many of you know this passage. A worthy walk involves being filled with the Spirit so that we walk in the Spirit so that the fruit of the Spirit is manifest in our lives. And what are the fruit of the Spirit? Love. That we are loving people. Joy. The joy of the Lord in our life. Peace. The peace of God that surpasses understanding. Patience with others. Kindness. Goodness. Faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. You see, Paul desired that the Colossians manifest these things in their daily conduct. And he prayed to the Father that the Father would not just help them to know the will of God, but also to walk in a worthy manner. And beloved, if we're honest, we know all of us fail in this respect. From time to time, we're not always walking worthy of our calling, right? If we are saints by position, unfortunately, we're not always saints by practice. But we need to keep growing and keep improving and becoming more godly and more righteous as we grow in our life. In Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 to 11, we have Paul's prayer for the Philippians. And notice how similar it is to his prayer for the Colossians. He says to the Philippians in Philippians 1:9, "It is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with what? Knowledge and discernment." See, he prayed for them, that they would grow in knowledge and discernment. "So that you may approve what is excellent and be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Filled with the fruit of what? Righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God." And so here we see the fruit of righteousness, a righteous, godly life. And as believers in the Lord Jesus, we need to pray for one another that we will walk worthy of the Lord, that we might manifest the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, and that we might live righteous, godly lives which glorify and please God. So knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, a worthy walk bearing fruit. Thirdly, in verse 11, another prayer request was that they would be strengthened with all power according to His glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy. So a third prayer request was that the Colossians would be strengthened, that spiritually they would be strong, that they would be stable, and that they would be strengthened for endurance. When we studied Hebrews, we saw that the Christian life is not a sprint. What is it? It's a marathon. And we need strength from the Lord to endure all the trials and tribulations of life and to go through life strong in faith, giving glory to God. And we need inner strength from the Lord to do that. And it's interesting that he says, strengthen for endurance with joy. It's not just that we are to grit our teeth and endure this terrible life. No, we are to go through our life with joy. And so Paul prays for the Colossians that they will have spiritual strength so that they can endure with a joyful spirit and a joyful heart. And after all, joy is another one of those fruit of the Spirit, right? And sometimes we endure, but we lose our joy, right? Because we're not have our eyes on the Lord, but on our circumstances. Paul also prayed for the Ephesians for this spiritual strength. In Ephesians 3, verses 14 to 16, his prayer for the Ephesians, also for spiritual strength. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be, what? Strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being. In your inner being. And so, again, Paul prayed for the Ephesians and the Colossians for spiritual strength, for endurance with joy. And we remember that Paul had written to the Philippians that we are to rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. So, we pray for knowledge, a worthy walk, spiritual strength. The last one we find in verses 12 to 14. And that is that he prayed that they would have an attitude of gratitude and thanksgiving to God the Father. That they would give thanks to the Lord in everything. He says in verse 12, giving thanks to the Father. He prayed that they would go through their lives with a thankful heart, a thankful spirit, and continually thanking God the Father for all things in life. Not just his blessings, but also the trials and tribulations that help us grow, for his grace, for his mercy, for his goodness, being thankful to God the Father. And he then mentions three particular things of why we can give thanks to God the Father. Three things that God the Father has done for us that should motivate us to be thankful for Him every single day of our lives. The first one we see here in verse 12, he says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Beloved, do you realize that God the Father has made us qualified to our eternal inheritance? Before you and I were saved, before we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we were disqualified. We were not qualified. We were dead in trespasses and sins. And we were not heading to an eternal inheritance that we would receive from the Lord. but God the Father, when we placed our faith in His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, He qualified us to that inheritance. That's one reason why we have that as a blessed hope, because we are now qualified. Think about that. You know all your sin. I know all of my sin, iniquity, and yet we have forgiveness of sins and we are qualified to an eternal inheritance. That is something to be thankful for. Not only has He qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints, verse 13 points out that God the Father is the one who has delivered us and transferred us. It says He, God the Father, has delivered us from what? From the domain of darkness. And He has transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son. God the Father is the one who delivered us from the domain of darkness. Peter wrote in 2 Peter 1:4 that as believers, we have escaped the corruption, the depravity that is in the world through lusts. We have escaped. We have been delivered from the domain of darkness, of sin, of blindness. God the Father is the one who delivered us from that. And not only has He delivered us from that, He has transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son. We are now sons of God through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We are now no longer a part of Satan's domain of darkness in this world. We have been transferred by God the Father into the kingdom of His beloved Son. In Acts 26, verse 18, the Apostle Paul, defending his ministry to King Agrippa, told Agrippa about Jesus appearing to him and his ministry calling. This is what Paul was sent to do to the Gentiles. Acts 26, verse 18. Paul was sent to them to open their eyes so that they might turn from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. So Paul's ministry of preaching the gospel was for this very reason, so that when they believed, God the Father would take them from the power of darkness, from the kingdom of Satan in this world, and transfer them into the kingdom of God. Beloved, do you know that's what happened to you when you got saved? You were delivered from the domain of darkness. You were transferred into the kingdom of His beloved Son. Is that something worth thanking God the Father for every single day of our lives? Sure is. We need to be thankful. He has qualified us to share in the inheritance. He has delivered and transferred us. And finally, last verse 14, we see what else God the Father has done for us that elicits our thanksgiving. Talking about the Lord Jesus, in whom, in Christ, we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. You see, in Christ, God the Father has given us redemption. He has brought us back from slavery to sin, right? And not only that, He has given us forgiveness of sins. God the Father, because of the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Son, has given believers forgiveness of all our sins. In Ephesians 1:7, Paul put it this way, in Him, in Christ, we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of His grace. And the riches of His grace are infinite and complete. And so, beloved, when Paul prays for the Colossians, he prays that they grow in their knowledge of the Word of God, right? The knowledge of the truth, And of course, if we're going to grow in our knowledge of Scripture, we have to study, right? We have to put in the work. So he prays that they would grow in their knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. He prays that they would walk worthy, godly, righteous lives filled with the fruit of the Spirit. He prays that they would be strengthened for endurance with great joy. And he prays that they will be thankful to God the Father, who has qualified us, delivered us, transferred us, redeemed us, and forgiven us. And so in these verses, Paul expresses his gratitude to the Father for the faith of the Colossians, and he also prays for their spiritual growth. And beloved, this is the prayers of the elders for each one of you. These are the prayers we need to be praying for one another, so that we will glorify God in our lives individually and also collectively as a church. Now, the last verse we looked at, verse 14, Paul wrote that it was in whom, in Christ, we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. What Paul is going to do now, and we'll pick it up in verse 15 next week, you can read ahead if you want, he's going to talk about the Lord Jesus Christ, the one in whom we have that redemption and forgiveness. And we're going to look at that glorious passage about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, his reconciliation ministry on our behalf on the cross, and also Paul's ministry for Christ as Paul was sent into all the world to preach this marvelous gospel. And so for all of you taking the Grace Evangelism course, keep coming, because the gospel is effective. It works. And aren't we glad that it worked in each one of our lives for the glory of God? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word today. And Lord, even though this is part of Paul's introduction, we see such glorious truth revealed here to us. And Father, we thank you for the faith, the love, and the hope that the Colossians possessed, which we also have, which we learned in the Word of God, the gospel of truth. And we thank you that the gospel bears fruit, and it has borne fruit in our lives. And Father, our prayer would be that you might help us to continue to grow in our knowledge and understanding of your will and your word. Help us to walk worthy of the great high calling we have in Jesus Christ. Strengthen us by your power so that we could endure with great joy. And Lord, help us to always be thankful. May we not be among those who are complaining and grumbling, but that we might glorify you through always having an attitude of gratitude. So, Lord, thank you for your word today, and help us to live our lives in light of it. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.